3, 2, 1, Schnitzelhammer International Review.
Yeah, hello and welcome very much to a new S-Lab Schnitzelhammer video. So in this video today, I want to present you my pros and cons after having used the new Sony RX10 Mark IV during 3 months, and I want to share my experience with you. All in all, I can tell you I'm very happy with this machine, but there is also some negative points which I want to mention first, and then we come to the positive ones. First, it's a small point. This connector for the tripod, I find it a little bit too much in the end of the camera. I would like to have it here, but most probably this is not possible because of the lenses inside the body. Next point to mention urgently, this is the menu. Unfortunately, it's not possible to install the good old Sony Play Memories apps inside this menu anymore, and therefore we cannot use the time-lapse software, which was so handy to have it inside the camera. This is very bad that Sony didn't give us the possibility to install this elderly apps inside this machine. With the new Sony A9 or even with the new Sony A7R Mark III, you have the time menu up here. I think it's called Q&S menu, and there you have access to some kind of slow motion or time-lapse functions directly in this menu, but it is missing in this camera, and I guess they're going to bring it out with the following version, but this is how Sony tries to trick us from time to time, as we know. Next point, the display. You can bend it in these kind of directions, which is not bad, yes, okay, but it would be so handy also to be able to fold it forwards, like for example in the Panasonic ones or in some of the other concurrents products. Imagine you could bend it down or bend it up, like in some other Sony cameras also. So if you want to make some kind of selfie mode, Sony is selling external monitors, but this is something else that you need to buy, and I think it could just be nice to be able to see what's going on without having to record and then run around and look from the other side of the camera. Next point, inside this camera, an ND filter is missing, which can be interesting for video effects sometimes, especially also because you have this gliding functions for all the apertures, yeah, so you can smoothly change between the apertures. It could be nice to create some video effects like this, but you don't have an ND filter, and so you have to screw your own ND filter in front. It's a 72 mm. Next point, since we were speaking about the menus already, it's not possible to use the menus in touch modus, which could be more handy for some people who are used to use the menus of the cell phone like this, or maybe in some other cameras also. You can directly make your settings like this. This is not possible with this machine. I personally don't miss this function so much. On the other hand, this camera has a touch focus. The problem is when you want to use it in selfie mode, you will try to turn it around like this. And then problem is sometimes I was unintentionally touching a little bit here, and so then the focus was fixed into this corner of the image, and then the result was out of focus. This was very bad, but in the end I found out it's possible inside the menus to completely deactivate touch focus, and then this problem didn't appear anymore. The last little negative point about this camera is that already when you come to focal length of 100, you will be going down from aperture 2.4 to 4.0. That means zooming into the long distance, you will lose some kind of light. It could be more nice to have a permanent lens opening from 2.4 using 24 to 600 millimeter zoom. But maybe also technically it was not really possible to build such a thing by now. In the end of the negative points, there is one dream. I was just wishing this camera, it is such a nice and professional tool, but it has this 1-inch sensor. Actually, it leads to excellent results. The quality is super, but I just imagined to have a full frame sensor inside this little box here. This would be perfect. What would happen then? If this was a full frame sensor, we would go from 8 mm to 220, which in the end, it's actually even written here. And this would mean 8 mm, we would have a strong wide angle image. So then there would not really be any lens missing in this camera anymore, and we could even zoom into 220mm, which then would be even pushed by the clear image zoom or even the digital zoom, which is also included in this machine. So from this point of view, this could be the most perfect innovation for this camera. Just Sony, please change the 1-inch sensor for your newest full-frame sensor, which we also find in the Alpha 7 R Mark III. So now for the positive points. First, we have a very fast eye focus and autofocus in this camera. This is really convincing. If you're interested in this, then just look up here in the corner. We have a video specifically for autofocus if this is an interesting topic for you. Also, when it comes to high-speed burst shooting, this camera, because of the small sensor, readout time is not so high. It can shoot up to 24 images per second. So this is like almost filming while doing photographs. This is also good for very interesting slow motion effects. If you want to know more about this function, then you can just look up now in this corner here. This video shows you how it is functioning and what kind of incredible results, especially comparing to the RX10 Mark III. Next point, this camera, to my point of view, has a very low noise while shooting in different ISO settings. So this is really convincing. The sensor which is built here, it's a big improvement comparing to the RX10 Mark III before, because I was working with both of these cameras. If you want to see a video about these different ISO levels, then just check in the corner up here. Next thing, this camera has also a touch focus. So you can shift the focus between different objects just using your finger. But actually, to be honest, I don't use this function so much. I'm more happy to put the focusing system onto this kind of wheel. The next really unbeatable point about this camera is the zoom. Even when you go to 600mm, you are already 25 times closer. Same thing also when you do photographs. Then next, if this isn't enough, you can add the clear image zoom. And using the clear image zoom, you get twice as close. So you have 50 times magnification. And if this is still not enough, you can use the digital zoom, which will crop into the sensor accordingly, which allows you 100 times magnification of the object that you want to photograph or film. This is just pure madness. If you're interested in the topic of zooming, then just look up here. We have this video about the different zoom levels. It can be interesting for you. Next point is about image stabilization. When you look here, this option, the standard steady shot in video, for example, it can be used even with 4K recordings. Then also you have an active steady shot or even an intelligent active steady shot, which is also possible to use, but then you have to switch down to HD resolution. If you're interested in the different steady shot modes under extreme conditions, then just check our video about steady shot up here. Next thing, really interesting, it's the HFR function, which allows you to film video sequences with up to 1000 images per second, and in this camera, even in the high quality mode, up to 4 seconds. But then with 1000 images per second, the quality is not so good anymore. But if you go down to 250 images per second, which also results in an interesting slow motion effect, then this camera has a resolution of almost HD quality. We are right now working on a video comparison of the HFR modus between RX10 Mark IV and the new RX0. So if you want to check this, please don't forget to follow the Schnittlabor channel. Next point, the battery of this RX10 Mark IV is really good. This is still the small one, not the bigger one, which you can now find in, for example, the Sony A9. The battery lasts much longer using this camera as, for example, comparing to the elderly Sony Alpha 7 R Mark II. At the same time, it's also possible to directly charge the camera or provide electricity from outside while you are doing photographs or while you are filming. In so far, you don't really need to worry about battery. If you have just a second battery to put in here, usually you will get through your photo day. Now we come to the last positive point, and this is maybe not really so obvious. You know, in this camera here, you have all necessary focal length for common use in one machine. You don't need to carry around a huge backpack with different lenses and so on. At the same time, because this one here, it is closed, you cannot remove it, there will be no dust coming in. And also it has like a water protection. So that means this camera is so compact and you have your whole photo backpack in one machine, which is just super compact and super convenient. And then you might think, okay, if you have an aperture of 2.4 up to 4, then maybe you cannot create interesting depth of field effects. But no, it is not true. I will show you now some photographs which I produced with this camera. And here you can really see that even very interesting depth of field effects are possible. The point is, for me, it led to the decision to sell my Sony Alpha 7 R Mark II. And from the money which I will get out of this selling, I will start to make a little world travel where I will just be using this RX10 Mark IV together with the handy camera which I'm using right now for filming this video. Because I think it's maybe much more interesting to check some places in the world instead of sitting in one place and being equipped with technologies. So that means right now a new chapter of Schnittlabor is starting. It's going to be very interesting. Never mind, enjoy your day and please come back soon.